Greetings. Almost live. From the moon, hey. It's Fran. Again. At the moon base. It's not a green screen. Not a red screen. It's just out the window. So I've been, as you know, if you've been tuning in, I've been spending weeks setting up the moon base, broadcasting on low band radio at 15 IPS. Got the little spinning color wheel in the black and white camera. Hopefully the audio and video are synchronized, should be synchronized, but I've got a huge delay. Actually, I tried broadcasting as this was delayed about 10 minutes. Those of you who were in early and saw the other broadcast start, I got an error from YouTube that this resolution is not supported for live streaming in this configuration, and I had to go in and figure out exactly what that configuration was. And without them really telling me, I just assumed that it was that I had the latency set up to low, and it conked me out. So I had to set it for low latency, for regular latency, and restart it. A little late. I'm also broadcasting at 2200 hours Greenwich Mean Time. As opposed to 2100 hours, because a lot of people kind of missed the other broadcast. I'm trying, you know, it's a worldwide broadcast and people got to sleep. Most people sleep at night. I don't usually, but trying to find the time to broadcast when most people would be awake or not at work or eating or doing stuff. So trying to arrange a compromise between people watching in the U.S. on the West Coast, and those of you in Europe. And it's kind of early in Australia, New Zealand, in the Pacific, but got to broadcast it sometime, somewhere on the planet. Someone got to sleep, so. All right. So I did this video on my RCA record player this past week. A lot of views and a lot of comments, and one of the interesting things about that I didn't put in the video, I just forgot about it, was when I did the restoration on that, I recapped it last year, and RCA, okay, so there's a very legendary fight between RCA and the Dumont Corporation in the early 50s, because Dumont had a television network, was competing with RCA's television network and NBC and all, and the huge, like, legendary rivalry in broadcasting. And so how shocked was I that when I went in and was restoring this turntable, that the capacitors, the original capacitors, are, come on, do it. What's on here? There we go. The original capacitors are all Dumont caps. I was like, you gotta be kidding me. I mean, that's like, it's just so weird. I mean, it's like, there's really no modern equivalent for it, but it's like if you hacked into an iPhone and found out that it had Microsoft firmware in it, would kind of be the equivalent. So, oh, come on. All right, my encoder's screaming clock. Got the 8-core running, so. Yeah, Dumont. Yeah, Jackie Gleason was on the Dumont network. In fact, when I was in radio, the FM station that I worked at was at the top of a mountain, sort of a quote-unquote mountain, and broadcast out of an old Dumont television building. And at night, I worked late at night and sometimes take a walk around the building, and they still had, back in the early 90s, still had the old Dumont Broadcasting Room with the old 50s televisions, and the concrete block was painted with like a Western scene for like a kiddie show or something. It was really kind of wild. But yeah, it was an old Dumont station. Went dark, I think, in 54. I think the Dumont network went off the air. They made televisions, too. And apparently, all the capacitors for the cheaper RCA stuff. So that was kind of interesting. Also, that video with the turntable got copyright slammed. Actually, I posted it. I was up all night. It was one of those all-day, all-night things where I shot all day and edited into the evening, and I uploaded it to YouTube and was going to make it, like, you know, live at 3 o'clock in the morning, and it got slammed with a copyright violation. I had to go back and re-edit it and redact the material with a copyright. This is my endless frustration with copyright, because it's all because of Sonny Bono. The Sonny Bono law that he passed in the 70s. You know, there used to be a time, especially when I was younger, when there was a lot of public domain music. I mean, if you had a record that hadn't been in print in any format for like 50 years, I forget exactly what the number was, but it was like 50 years, it was public domain. But since that law went into effect, pretty much every piece of music that you're going to find is copyrighted by someone. And even stuff that was public domain, that all the stuff that like used to be fell in the public domain is now copyrighted, because I have a lot of records that have not been in print in any form since the 40s or 50s. And I put them on YouTube and they get slammed with a copyright violation. It can't be legal. But, you know, it's one of those things where music, when the music copywriting became such a commodity with the internet age, you know, lawyers just started buying up copyright. They're traded like commodities, like stocks, you know, like, you know, pork bellies and salt futures and stuff. It's just, and you know, people have this idea that when you pay a royalty on a copyright claim that it's going to the artist or some form, but that's very rare. I mean, a vast majority of copyright claims, and I mean the ones for songs that you've never heard of, you know? I mean, people think of copyright law as like stuff that's in print now, and that's just like a tiny percentage of the total copyright, like, copyrights that exist. And the vast majority of them, all the money just goes to a lawyer who has absolutely no relation to the artist or the artist's family or anything like that. It's just something that they bought at an auction, and they litigate to fight, fight their copyright claim. And when you take him along, YouTube is like it's just like a cornucopia for lawyers. You know, copyright claims go on one side, and just the money just funnels into the tiny little end. And some lawyer sitting there just guzzling up the returns. You know, it's just, I'm really upset about it. It's like, with the new laws, most of the copyrights in the 20th century won't expire until the mid, like, 2050s or something, or maybe even longer than that, but anyway. So, we got 172 people watching, got the chat going, so I'm kind of looking at the chat while talking. My multitasking, I can either do one or the other. Huh. Yeah. So, this live broadcast, it might get slammed with a copyright claim. I got this clip that I made just because it's so ridiculous. The idea, those of you abroad in other countries, I'm sure, maybe have heard about it too. But there's a ridiculous proposal in our country to have a new branch of the military called the Space Force, and I think I know exactly where this comes from, because here on the moon base, we had a problem with that clone who was found mining tritium on the dark side, and then we had all those moon Nazis like a decade ago that raised hell, came from the dark side of the moon, you know, and then Drax and all those guys. I mean, we have all these evildoers in space. We got to do something about it, you know. the document records are there for you to see on YouTube of all these evil guys that have come to space to take it over. But what no one is talking about the Space Force thing, other than the fact that it's a completely new branch of the military, and we already spend the vast majority of our gross national product on our current military, and they just want to increase that by another fifth. Or they want to take a fifth away from all the other current budget of military and put it towards the Space Force. But it goes against, I mean, we already, the United States drafted the 66, 67 space non-proliferation treaty agreement. That was pushed by the United States and Russia and ratified, signed by the United States and everything. It strictly forbids the militarization of space. We drafted that legislation. You know, we pushed it through the United Nations and all, you know, countries signed it. We signed it. Russia signed it. Expressly forbids the militarization of space and makes it illegal to put weapons in space. So, and of course, I think I know where this came from, and that there's this new Space Force theme, and I sort of made a little clip to show where the idea comes from.
Makes it up here in space, not on Earth. They have to come to us, whoever can afford to. In space, I guess we'll fight Elon Musk. In space,
we are the Space Force, Space Force. This is a bad idea, of course. Space Force, Space Force. Pew, 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 pew. Trump is king, Trump is king, Trump is king.
Okay. Oh, come on. Come on. You can do it. Come on. Do it. Switch. Yes. My encoder is lagging a little bit. Anyway, that's sort of my take on the origins of Space Force. So, yeah, the Samantha Bee Show ran that, and I really liked the way they organized the choir and everything. It was just, it sounded so legitimate. So, yeah, Space Force theme. Come into an orbit near you. I really hope not. I really, really hope not. It's such a stupid, bad idea. My other rant was that I was at the shop, stationery store, and I saw that Dixon Ticonderoga has now advertised as the world's best pencil. And I went, not even like America's best pencil. Which I don't even think it's America's best pencil. I mean, the Ticonderoga is a good pencil. Don't get me wrong. It's a good pencil. And it probably, if you just used a Dixon Ticonderoga your whole life, you probably wouldn't be missing out on anything. It's a very good writing pencil. But it's not the world's best pencil. It's like if Chevrolet made it their slogan, the world's best car. You know? It's like, I'm sure if you drive a Chevrolet, you probably wouldn't ever want for anything else but Porsche and Ferrari and Bugatti and Rolls-Royce and Koenigsegg. They would probably all take task with your slogan of claiming the world's best car. It's like, yeah, there's good, and then there's the best. But the best pencil in the world is the Palomino Blackwing. That's just, I'm sorry. Yeah. It's not even like the best American pencil, because the America's pencil, I think, makes the better pencil because it's solid cedar, the weight's better. It's just, you know, if you write with pencils all the time, it's all about the details, the specific weight, the kind of cedar, you know, there are details in it. And it's just like, you know, it's like, if you're a 10-year-old, a Ticonderoga is fine, you know, or it's fine for office use, but if you write with pencils every day and if pencils are your life, chances are good you're not writing with the Dixon Ticonderoga. So, yeah. That's the end of my pencil rant. Okay. Yes, okay. Fran is not really on the moon. You can tell because of the pixels. Yeah, there you go. I don't know. It's not green screen. So, it's gotta be something. Can't be my office in Philadelphia. That just wouldn't make sense. So, yeah, that's kind of everything on my list. Hey, Germany. Anybody got any questions? Hello from Scotland. Hello. How'd you get through the Van Allen belt, Fran? Everyone just fly through it. The Van Allen belt was sort of a... They really thought early on that the radiation levels in deep space would be a lot higher than they were, but it's really just very lucky that there weren't any intense solar storms during the Apollo missions. I mean, they had a plan for that, you know, to get in the command module and point the tail end towards the eruption, kind of ride it out. But they did have a lot of problems with high Z particles, and Buzz Aldrin and others noted in the retinas they could see these flashes of light of high energy particles going through the spacecraft and hitting the retina. Kind of high energy particles that we just don't get here on the surface of the Earth, but a human being can go through a decent amount of radiation and not get all the chromosomes scrambled. See, it's like we get hit with high energy radiation all the time, and it's part of the biological necessity. The reason we have an immune system is that we always have genetic mutations, and gamma rays and other higher energy particles occasionally fracture our DNA, and it's up to our bodies to find those cells and eliminate them. And most always we do. It's, you know, when we start to get sick when our bodies stop doing that. Or when you get hit with so much radiation that you get so much cellular damage that your body simply can't deal with it. And there are lots of other issues with that. But, you know, there are other people, and there are people who survived Hiroshima, who got burned and everything, and like lived later, and like didn't necessarily die of cancer. It's all a matter of odds, you know. It's all about odds. But yeah, you can fly in deep space. I think that, you know, if Elon Musk decides to go to Mars, if he really does go to Mars, the biggest challenge is going to be finding out exactly how much cosmic radiation the human body can withstand. If we ever went to Mars and colonized Mars, there would be issues of disease up there that we're not used to on Earth, simply because, you know, Mars doesn't have a magnetic field. It's not really, doesn't really have the ray shielding for some of these really energetic particles. It'll be a test, for sure. Hey, Spain. Where's your Hasselblad? It's in the other room. It's in the other room. With the flag. The flag's over there. All of you on the good Earth over there. Yeah, I can see Madagascar coming around. So bring back some rock. I'll grab a handful before I head back. What's the best cheap soldering iron? I don't think there's such a thing. You get what you pay for. I've always used Wellers. I've never used anything but Wellers. Still using my original 78, 60-watt Weller, you know. Still going strong. Mars may have viruses. It's hard to say. I mean, even since Viking, they've been looking for the kind of organic compounds that would allow for viruses and bacteria. I don't know. It's hard to say. I mean, the interesting thing is that the new geological evidence, because now that, you know, geology and genetic science is starting to kind of intertwine, they've kind of found fossilized records of bacteria going back almost over 3.5 billion years. So it's kind of amazing that almost as soon as the Earth was cooled that the electrochemical processes for the first amino acids and stuff were already starting. It happened very early. So if Mars was Mars was wet and warm back then, it could have had some start to life, you know. Be interesting as we get in, you know, I'd really like to see an exploration of Europa and the outer solar system. Now, if we're going to find life in the solar system other than on our little blue planet, it's probably going to be on Europa or Ganymede or Europa. Well, blue cheese, yeah. If Mars had viruses, would be able to infect humans? That is a very good question. It's like whenever I watch science fiction movies like Alien Covenant, the one that was recently out, where they just land on an alien planet, no spaces or anything. They just land on the planet. Oh, there's plants. Let's just land there. Oh, let's just walk around. Let's just walk around. What harm could come? It's like the very first thing is, you never land on an alien planet that has life on it, for God's sake. I mean, that's like the last thing you want to do, you know? And you got, it's like, yeah, but viruses, it's difficult to say, because viruses are, they tend to be specific. I guess the answer is viruses on Earth are kind of specific to cell, because their receptors latch on to signatures on specific kinds of cell walls. That's why, like, if you've got a cat can get a virus that you don't get, and you can get a virus that your cat won't get. But there are crossover viruses, like HIV was a virus in primates that crossed over to humans, because sometimes, and some of the worst infections we get are from our cross species, like, you know, avian flu, the plague. the most deadly pandemics come from viruses that are not unique to our species. They tend to come cross species, so yeah. We have to definitely watch out for anything, especially if we bring back anything from Mars. We bring back soil. You have to be very careful with that. That because if the chance that there is anything in there, you know, it could be something that we wouldn't be able to stop necessarily with our kind of chemistry. Very dangerous to bring stuff back. Reading the chat. Oh, we got 209 people on. And we're 28 minutes in, we're still in the orange, and still broadcasting, so. Still reading the chat. It's going so fast. I'm trying to read the questions, but it's going really fast. Is there a base on Mars? Not yet. Well, it depends. I mean, if you count Curiosity, you could count Curiosity as a Mars base, because it's been up there for years, so. Could count that. Hey, from Buffalo, how are you? Tardigrades, yes. Tardigrades should be our emissaries to Mars. We should just put some tardigrades up there. They'd be flourishing on Mars as it is. Yeah. Good old tardigrades. Hey, Nottingham. Is it possible to bring Earth viruses to Mars? Yes. In fact, actually, that's one of the great concerns whenever we put space probes up, because they have one of the first things they did, Apollo 12, when they landed, the Apollo 12 had two objectives. One was that we had put down a lander on the moon, and so they knew where that lander was. Was it Explorer? We knew where that lander was on the moon, and so their job was to get as close to that lander as they could, number one, to see if they could target landing, which they did. They were within walking distance of it. And then the second thing was that they went over to the lander, which had a camera platform on it, and they had bolt cutters to cut the bolts and take the camera off and return that. They put it in a hermetically sealed bag on the moon, and brought that back to Earth, because they wanted to see if any bacteria could have survived the trip and to the moon. And so they took swabs off of that camera when it got back to a completely sterile lab, and put it in petri dishes, and sure enough, they cultivated bacteria that had been on the moon for the better part of a year. So it definitely proved that, yeah, bacteria can, if it gets in, bacteria can survive in space, and they can be reanimated when they get in an environment where they can proliferate. So, and that was really the thing about the, that really brought along the whole idea of panspermia, what was it, panspermia? The transplantation of simple life from one rock to another. And the possibility that life could survive in space, who knows how long? Years, hundreds of years, centuries, millennia, who knows? Eons? We don't know. But yeah, that's whenever spacecraft go to other planets, they do their best to sterilize them before they put them in the wrap them up and put them in the the launch vehicle. So it's a big concern, especially like that's why they burn up spacecraft like Galileo and Cassini. They burned up Cassini because they didn't want Cassini to crash land on them, you know, or and Galileo. They don't want those spacecraft to crash land on any of the moons that we want to explore that might have indigenous life. You know, if Galileo would have gotten lost in Jupiter's orbit and crash landed on Europa, it would, you know, that whole thing about panspermia, where if we have a human spacecraft with bacteria on it that we put into the orbit of another planet and it crashes on a moon that's habitable to life, well then we just put our own junk life there and it'll proliferate. So that's why we burn up spacecraft when they're close to the end of their lifespan. We burn them up intentionally to prevent that from happening. Pharynx, thank you. Thank you, beam me up, Scott. That's pharynx is what I was trying to think of. Pharynx, yes. And a massive autoclave, yes. There's lots of precautions with spacecraft that will leave the proximity of Earth. Yes. Satellites are temporary. Well, yeah. Satellites are temporary because of the drag of the atmosphere. There's no part where the atmosphere just ends. It's after 50 to 60, 70 miles, it just becomes increasingly rarefied. So low Earth orbit satellites, they hit atmospheric resistance all the time, and they will slow down and deorbit. That's why Skylab came down, and that's why they have engines on the ISS, because they've got to, you know, nudge it every now and then, keep it in orbit. And if you, any satellite in low Earth orbit, if you don't nudge it every now and then, it will deorbit. And even satellites out, all the way out in geostationary orbit, they still will slow down eventually. You know, eventually. Take a long, long, long time, but they will slow down. That's why satellites for their, you know, useful lifetime, they have to have gaseous maneuvering engines to stay in orbit, because they have to correct their orbit every now and then. Reading, reading, reading. So what do you think of the Space Force idea? You have to watch the rebroadcast if you missed my earlier thing. If you missed my earlier clip. Do you think radio research for extraterrestrials is still viable? That's a very good question. Yes, I definitely think we should keep looking. Because we've only actually looked at a very small portion of the sky in celestial terms. It's this Fermi paradox. And Carl Sagan wrote a lot about it and talked about the Fermi paradox and had his own sort of take on the equations. And it's interesting that in the 60s, 70s, when they talked about about this whole question of why haven't we found extraterrestrial transmissions? Because when radio astronomy started, when they started pointing dishes at the sky, And first they found the background radiation, and then the next big thing was that they found these beacons, these celestial beacons, which turned out to be pulsars, and discovered pulsars with radio antennas. But as long as we've been listening out there, I mean, when people started thinking, oh, we should point our antennas up there, and we have all these tuned ears, I think early on they were so optimistic that all we have to do is turn on the radio and listen, and someone's broadcasting. We just have to look for it. And there was a great deal of optimism. And as the years went on and decades went on, the quietness of the sky looking for radio transmissions really, really, really begged the question about why aren't we just picking up radio signals everywhere? And there's two ways of looking at it. Either people are transmitting everywhere and you're just not looking in the right spot and you're not listening on the right frequency, or they're out there but they're not transmitting in radio. And I think part of the answer lies in our own civilization, because we're at the point now where our own civilization is not really transmitting radio anymore. We've turned off our analog television broadcasts, and in many regions of the world, we've turned off our analog radio broadcasts. So we are starting to turn off our radios and go to a new kind of high-frequency, digital way of communicating in our own planet. And, if we stop using the longer waves, see, that's the thing, you know, higher the frequency waves, they take a lot more power. And because of the inverse square law, they lose power a lot faster. So the really, really high frequency stuff in an unfocused beam, like an unfocused transmitter, the higher the frequency, the closer you have to be to pick it up. So as we go to higher and higher frequencies, we're transmitting in higher and higher frequencies for our own use, and we're not using shortwave and the television transmissions for analog waves that someone could easily decipher. Well, we're going quiet, you see. And it's been 100 years, you know? So I think the probably the most reasonable answer to the Fermi paradox is that radio just, if you get to a point where your civilization starts using radio, they don't use it for very long, because once you get into analog radio, you start uncovering new ways of encoding information and higher frequencies, and you stop using the lower frequencies, because when we search the skies, we're searching for broadcasts in the lower frequencies. So I do think that it's a combination of factors. The other thing too that has to be considered is the self-destruction part of the paradox, where, you know, how many species, when they reach a point of technology, destroy themselves inadvertently or on purpose, either they reproduce so fast that they exhaust their planet's resources and they can no longer fight famine, or they invite pandemics, or they start their civilizations by using the cheapest and most available fuel source, which is carbon. You know, on any planet where life is going to become intelligent, you've got a lot of carbon, because you're going to have whatever the extraterrestrial version of petroleum or coal is, because it just occurs there's going to be some kind of carbon deposit, and they're going to burn that to build their civilization. And maybe destroying the atmosphere is a big part of the paradox. You know, maybe a lot of these technologies reach a point of becoming radio transmitting species, and then they wreck their ability to maintain their technology or maintain their population to a point where they're broadcasting radio and they go dark. Or maybe they just evolve out of radio and start using, maybe within a few centuries of using radio, people discover quantum entanglement and start entangling electrons. And boy, you know, once you get quantum entanglement, radio is just, that's so two centuries ago, you know? Then you're just, doesn't matter how far away you are, it's just everything's real time, no lag, quantum entanglement. You know, you start quantum entangling electrons, and you get these transmitter-receiver pairs where you get a chip that's got one particle in it and another chip that's got another particle, and they're quantum entangled. You put this in your transmitting device, you put this in your receiving device, you could put that device on the another planet, on the other side of the solar system, and there's no delays. Boom. And so you just you put digital data into that one particle, you receive it in the other, and that's it. Radio's gone. So lots of reasons. But one thing's for sure, it's not loud out there. It's not like there's a whole lot of people on radio. But I think as time goes on, we might discover the reason for that, or just because of how we're evolving very quickly. That's, the questions are coming so fast now. If water did not come from space, the Earth must have made it. I think a lot of water came from comets. Early solar system was filled with water, and also we had a lot of methane in our atmosphere, and so electrical activity, just because of the fact we have this big iron core, we have a big, a lot of big electromagnetic field, and we have a lot of electricity, and broke up all the methane, and also early bacteria had a lot to do with the creating the oxygen, putting the oxygen in the atmosphere, you get oxygen, you break other carbon compounds and free up the hydrogen, you get you get water. And plus, lightning will create water and ozone and everything, so. But we got lots of water. Human body is not suitable for interstellar travel. Well, we'll find out, I think the human body is a lot more resilient. Some people will survive, some won't. Actually, the truth of it is the more time that human beings spend in space as a species, it's like anything else. There's going to be a process of natural selection where individuals that have genomes that are highly resistant to radiation will thrive, and the ones that don't won't. Just like anything else, we'll have a human version of a tardigrade that will be humans that for generations have been in space and just are very hardened to it. It's just that would happen, like anything else. Oh, the questions are going by so fast. String theory. I'm not ready to accept string theory yet. I'm not until, I'm very reluctant. I can't fully accept any kind of mathematical theory that is not provable in a repeatable experiment, and the traditional model of the quantum world is the only thing that's really verifiable through experimentation with particle accelerators. So I'm gonna dangle string theory on a very long arm. So maybe in a future chat I'll talk about my time theory at my own. Or I should say, it's not really theory, I guess I should say my time hypothesis. To the amplitude, exactly. Inverse square law, if you're trying to pick up a radio transmission from a star that's even in our own galaxy, it's got to be really loud, and I mean really loud, for us to pick it up on Earth. Especially through our atmosphere and everything. I mean, it'd have to be a beam aimed at our planet with so much energy, more energy than we can really imagine on Earth, to be able to hear it over vast interstellar distances. That's why, radio telescopes are great at picking up tremendously cataclysmic events, like black holes conking each other, or stars imploding, things like that are, loud and make radio waves and x-rays and infrared. When they get the new telescope, the far infrared telescope in orbit and functioning, that's going to be an eye-opener. When you see into the infrared, I think it's going to change everything when they get that up there, that new observatory. Would I like to space travel on my own? That's another rant altogether about billionaires going into space. I read an article where they said that, Virgin Galactic? It's Virgin Galactic, the suborbital trips. I think it's Virgin Galactic had, it's like $1 million a trip, or $1.5 million per flight, and Maybe it was that stinking space hotel they're going to build, but they had like 750 reservations at like $1 million. I'm like, what the fuck? Sorry, kids, but really, it's like, growing up in the 60s, watching astronauts like risk their life to go into space, and thinking that someday it would be open to everyone else. I mean, what we're building. I mean, no one is more impressed with Elon Musk putting his car in space than me, but what we're building on Earth right now is just the Elysium. It's like that really bad movie that had Jodie Foster in it or whatever. Elysium. That's what they're building. They're building the Trump Tower in space, where billionaires will fly into space and spend a weekend in orbit, and everybody else is just gonna sit here thinking about it, you know. And billionaires be doing selfies from orbit, you know. And that really pisses me off. The idea that none of these companies even have established lotteries, you know, just, you know, so that someone could just, you know, if you're gonna have a flights that cost $1 million, fine. But, you know, raffle off a thousand flights a year for $100. So that's, you know, give someone else a chance, you know, who's not a freaking billionaire. That's the big problem I have with the International Space Station when they started letting people pay, $1.75 million or $2 million to be a space tourist. I mean, what the freaking fuck, you know? Really against that. Really against it. So, I've been ranting for 47 minutes. I think I'm gonna go back to Earth. I got stuff to do there. We're not gonna talk any more about quantum physics or quantum mechanics for this one. I don't wanna lose too many people. 224 watching? All right. So, I am going to conclude this broadcast. I've ranted myself out 47 minutes. But I'll be back. I'm going to, since my stream feedback stream has stopped, I'm no longer seeing myself, but still in the orange. So, we're broadcasting, and we'll do this again real soon. I got some other videos I'm editing this week. Some other projects. I'm sort of behind on my editing compiling because I've got a bunch of projects that need some parts done, and I'm just hit some snags on some of my big projects that I really hoped to have done by now. So have a good flight. Thanks. Yeah, I'm number one on the runway. All right, thanks everybody. We'll see you around real soon. Bye.
Module. Can't imagine.